friendship is repeating. Sits here with something to believe in. And as we slip into the evening, the sun will set upon the starboard bow. Cause the good ship is a pleading. You will count for the storm that you never know. I don't want to rest the day. I just want to hear you say, oh Lord, the good ship is a Peter. Set sail with something to believe in. And as we slip into the evening, the sun will set upon the starboard bow. Caught the good ship is beating now. You asked me back, but I should have said no to you. But I said yes, and I still feel that I've let myself down. But I will never drown. Just as the good ship is repeating, just when we've something to believe in, and as we slip into the evening, the sun will set upon the starboard. Oh Lord, that good ship is repeating, set sail with something to believe in. Ship is a Peter, set sail with something to believe in. And as we slip into the evening, the sun will set upon the starboard bow. Caught the good ship is a Peter now. Oh, the good ship is a Peter now. Oh, the good ship is a
Hello, my name's Michael Casty. I'm a musician from Paisley. Originally from Paisley, now live in Glasgow, right beside Paisley. I released my debut album in 2015, and I'm gearing up to release my second album, which is exciting for me, even though my face doesn't really look like it's excited. It is excited. Inside, I'm excited. It's nice to be here in flat to write and sing some songs and meet some lovely people. And get some lovely glasses of water. Anything else I've been doing? Loads of gigging over the years. I've always kind of, I'm just turned 30 last week, and I've been pretty much kind of gigging musician for the last 10 years, maybe longer, actually longer, 12 years. And yeah, that's just kind of what I want to do. I've always done and thought I will do until I sniff it. I've got my debut album coming out in 2015, so that's still there. You can go and check that out. And I've got a headline King Tut show on the 17th of February, so if you are in, would like to come along to that, get your tickets for that, that'd be great to see you. And it's full band as well. So I've just found out that this episode's going out in March, so I hope you've enjoyed my King Tut's headline show a couple of weeks ago. And if you weren't there, like, woe betide you. My debut album, I was very lucky to work with a producer called Callum Malcolm, who worked on a lot of the Blue Rider stuff and things like that. A big, massive inspiration to me. And to work with those guys, and the kind of session musicians he brought in at the time was like, there was a guy called, a guy called Ian O'Rourke, who plays in a band called Lou, who's like one of my favourite musicians, and he played fiddle on it, and just a bunch of really amazing musicians to play on it, so I was very lucky. But since then I've worked my own band and kind of, and I've again blessed to have a really good group of musicians around me and stuff, so they're the guys who play on the second album. And yeah, so if you come and see the band live, that's the guys who play on the second album, will be the guys you see live and stuff, so yeah. Hi, welcome to Michael Casty Makes Cups of Tea. Today we're going to make 3 cups of tea, just simple. We're going to use my favourite milk, which is Müller whole milk. Expiry date, 8th of Feb, we're good there. Freshly boiled water, tea bags, and the brand is Yorkshire Yorkshire tea. You can tell by... Oh, no, it's a tetley. It's a tetley. Yep, it's a tetley. This is a couple of weeks ago, bought from a Morrison's, probably. I can smell it. It's very nice. So, good tea. We're going to shove that one in there. We're going to shove another one in there. I have the one that I've sniffed. Hands are washed as well. The one of the most important aspects of making tea is washing your hands before you pick up the tea bags. So I'm going to bring the cups closer to me. I'm going to take the kettle. I'm going to slowly pour them into the tea bag. Now I like to kind of do a slow pour to really infuse the tea and let the leaves breathe. Very slow. I mean, we're halfway now in terms of water fillage. And these cups are also very good because they come with a little cusp as well and like inside rim. It basically means that you can pour the water to that line and you've got a kind of perfect amount of tea to water to bag displacement, which is crucial in a perfect cup of tea. So we're two-thirds of the way there, 66.6 recurrent of the way through the whole tea making process. We're running out of water, but this may be a milkier tea, and yep, we've got the perfect amount of water in there, absolutely fine. So we're going to casually place that to the left hand side, which is nice. Hiya, how's it going? And then we're going to do the milk after this. These are three things. This would be unprofessional if I hadn't already previously asked my friends how much milk they have in, but I've already asked them, so they I can get, and they told me that one person takes a little dollop of milk and two sugars, and the other person said the exact same as well. So we're just going to pop a little bit of milk in there. And I do the milk before the sugar because I think that's quite a crucial. I think that the saccharine element of tea is the something that comes in at the very end. I feel kind of very much like a Top Chef, like a Ken Holm or a Gordon Ramsay will sprinkle parsley over a spaghetti after he's finished cooking said spaghetti. So there we go. And we've got a thing. Wait, now what I like to do is I like to take the tea bag out before the sugar goes in as well. I think that's a crucial element because then you get a sugar residue. Some of the sugar may get lost in the tea bag, which is a big no-no in the world of tea making. I'm okay just to put the tea bags on. I'm going to get a wee extra couple of minutes. If that's okay, a couple of seconds. We're just letting the tea bags infuse right now. Infuse. It's fine. I've said it. I'll make it right. We're going to let that really work its magic in with that hot water. Scottish hot water as well. It's the only water you can make proper tea with. And yeah, I think we're getting ready there. We're getting close to optimal. And we're getting close here. Shall I tell a joke to fill the time? How much does a shampoo cost in London? 10 cents. That was kind of Australian accent. I tried to do a London accent when I said Pantene, because that's a famous brand of hair product. And this mug is hard to get the tea bag out of because the little lip. And I wasn't using my fingers, but this is my cup, so I'm using fingers now. Right. And here we go. I think you'll be very happy with these teas. I think these teas are perfect. These teas are actually perfect. No one's ever going to be... I mean, I'm just waiting for the small molecules of sugar to finally dissolve into the... Probably now about 88 degrees temperature of the tea. And they have the sugar is no more. So there you have it. That's how to make perfect three cups of perfect Scottish tea. Tetley, sugar, water. What more do you need? Time, that's what you need. Enjoy.
turn these wheels away. No, I will keep turning till you hear me say, oh God, oh God, oh God, oh God, oh God, baby, oh God. I see you standing in the crowded subway. You're disappearing out of here. I lose your face amongst the crowd of people. I'm still not sure if it was you. I'm still not sure if I know what I belong, if I know what I am going to.
The last picture I took on my phone, is this going to be in shot, this phone? I don't want it to be, just so I can, in case there's anything dodgy. There's nothing dodgy, obviously. Oh no, it's so boring. Oh, it's like a screenshot of, like, I was getting, like, stuff printed, like, it's so boring. It's like an album printed, and it's like the quote from the CD replication company, and they've got the quote, and I took a screenshot of it so I'd remember the number. That's the only photo I've got on my phone. Like, it's actually so bad. Sorry. Like, I'm so rubbish. Before that, maybe like my niece or something, which is cute, but I think I deleted it because I've ruined my phone. That is the most boring question. You could do 25 seasons of this show, and that's the most boring response you'll get to that, I swear. Sorry. I'm sorry, general public. This question really, the first celebrity I remember fancying, this question honestly took me like a good few, like half an hour to work out. Now, I was quite a big Blue Peter fan, and it was, I think her name was Katie something. What was her name again? Katie. Could you do like a wee edit and we'll find out in between it? We've now had the confirmation it was Katie Hill, it was the Blue Peter presenter that I fancied, but also had a soft spot for Clarissa Explains It All, Melissa Joan Hart from that Clarissa Explains It All. Yeah, so one of them probably. So what is better, cats or dogs, or why? Not a massive fan of either, to be honest with you, but dogs are much better than cats, definitely. I've liked a couple of cats, but I've not really liked any cats, to be honest with you, but of the few dogs I've liked, they've been dogs. So they've not been cats, so there you go. So kick dogs. My most embarrassing memory is, I had a good think about this one, I was about 18, 19, and I was at some like bingo night thing, there was about 500 people there, and there was a, like, what's it called when you put tickets in for a, like a, Why isn't when, not bingo, but the thing when you go like a church thing and it's like people get your wee, no, like when you wee tickets.
Raffle.
There was a raffle and I bought like honestly about, I don't know, 20 raffle tickets, and it was such an oversubscribed raffle that not only did you have to get the colour and the ticket number right, you also had to get the wee code at the bottom, but I just, they called it my colour and the ticket number and I just went mad and jumped on the stage and done like the most ridiculous dance ever and was going mad because all my friends were just like, they hadn't put tickets and I was just like, yeah, get, yes. And then they checked the code and it was wrong and like the whole place was laughing at me, like every single person took great delight in laughing at me. I remember that vividly. My perfect dinner would be a kind of, some like top Asian chef and like a kind of chicken and prawn stuff, right, like really fresh and just the guy's just like on it and it's just like, it's just so nice and like really fresh ingredients and just like still like just beautiful fresh prawns and all that, and yeah, that'd be my favourite. But yeah, from past and present, my top five dinner party guests, this question has like caused me great concern because I kind of, I don't want to be like, it's like too stupid and then too like, because I'm trying too hard, but genuinely Spike Milligan, I want him there, definitely. I think he'd be just, I just think he'd be absolutely hilarious. And then, so that's like kind of more old, then kind of more modern. I always think Conan O'Brien's really, really funny. So I think they would hit it off. They'd be really funny and they would lead it. In fact, and just, I can have someone to join those two. I'd have Billy Connolly between those two, right? And then I would have, I think those three are quite, all quite clever and funny. So they would absolutely roast the living daylights out of Donald Trump, who'd be the fourth guest, right? And that'd be the whole reason he'd be there. It's like, I kind of like, even though I wouldn't want him there, I'm kind of getting a dinner party, but he'd be there and I think he'd really get taught a lesson. And then musical, someone like maybe, I'm between a few people. I'm a big Rufus Wainwright fan, but I think Dolly Parton would have like good anecdotes. She'd have a lot, she'd made a lot of good stories over the years, and then she'd play a few tunes at the end of the night. And she'd also have, she'd also like, kick the living crap out of Donald Trump as well, so I think those five would be good. My biggest fear would probably be, I listen to this podcast Case File and it's like they basically report all these like true crime over the years, like the last 100 years and all over the world. Probably the biggest fear is that I become like a statistic or something, part of one of them, or someone I know, like just horrible, like thinking, yeah, basically someone I know is murdered. So depressing. But that Case File was a really good podcast. You should listen to it. It's really good. But it's grim. And yeah, something that someone I know gets involved with that. Oh, I didn't even think this one. If I found a magic lamp, my three wishes would be, one would be just, even though it's later on, just like to get that kind of professional football contract. Like get signed up by like a top team, then get like a few Scotland caps. Like just someone just found me, like Michael. Even though I'm rubbish at football, someone said, Michael, you've been wasted all these years. That'd be one. Two would be a big meaty recording contract where I get to call all the shots. I get, and not just for the money, but I like full creative control. But they throw absolute millions of money into the PR campaigns and stuff, and I get going on amazing tours, but I get travel around the world basically with music. That'd be the big one. And I get to invite a lot of my friends on to kind of do it, to take part in it with me. So it's not that I get loads of money from it, but I get to bring everyone else involved with it. And three would probably be what's the thing called again, the magic lamp that destroys itself, so no one else can get any wishes, it's just me. Basically the world ends just with me, like with the top wishes, and it's just, that's how it continues until I die. Well, if I was a musician, I would be, well, when I was younger, for some reason I had this, like a customs agent, like someone who like, in the drug enforcement, I always thought that'd be really cool to check bags and like to like at the airport, or to go on missions where you have to basically like drug cartels, but not in, like in kind of more like down Scottish way, not in like the kind of Mexican way where you'll get your head chopped off or something, like proper, like just, I always thought that'd be really interesting. But as the older I get, the more grim I realise that the drug trade is, that probably, I don't know if that would be all it was going to cracked up to be, hey, there you go. I think I'm going to stay with my younger self. I think a kind of customs agent, yeah, I think that'd be interesting. Yeah, that'd be good. Well, if I had to change my name, my name would be Marcel Cunningham, because see that John Travolta Fire Name Generator thing when he said the name wrong at the Oscars like 3 years ago, that me and my band all put our names in the, we regularly do it, different people's names, the John Travolta Fire Name, and Michael Cassidy came out as Marcel Cunningham, so really that's the only reasonable answer. Or Parker, because whenever I see the name Parker, I'm like, that guy's, that's just so cool. Like Parker, oh, that's a cool name, isn't it?
Sometimes you cannot hear the dream. Like the damsel in that silent picture scream. Tell you it won't go down too well. Well, I'm not perfect, but you need someone's help. Mind is a mountain where some thoughts don't belong. Scrambling over heather, the wind is just too strong. The loose doors, they are slipping, and cloud is slowly filling all around. But ever is sometimes we refuse to talk. And years pass, and years pass. How long will it last? Mind is a mountain, some thoughts don't belong. Scrambling over heather, the wind is just too strong. Loose doors, they're slipping, the cloud is slowly filling all around. Forever is falling. Falling.
Right, there you go. Can you put your head down so you can get back in? Put my head down, there you go. Oh, wait, I'm right, there you are. Okay, sure.